Welcome everyone. We have with us Mr. Manish Dugar, CFO of Mphasis, with us. It's a very great privilege, Manish, to have you with us today.
My pleasure, absolutely.
The first thing, which is the most interesting thing about Manish, is Manish joined his new firm in May 2020. So Manish, I can't take out that option. So my first question would be around that. What was the expectation and what was the reality? March 2020.
So actually, I didn't join on May. I joined first week of March. I took over as the CFO in May. So I got maybe, 5 days of working from office before, we went to work from home. When you are joining a new firm, which is as distributed globally as Mphasis is, if you just think from a leadership perspective, Nitin, who is our CEO, sits in New York. Two of our business leaders sit in Bay Area. One business leader sits in Bombay. The head of delivery sits in Chennai. And so, none of us are in one location. And the organization is large, so large that, you need to connect and you need to meet a lot of people with whom you have to work. You have to kind of, get things done. My own team is kind of distributed all over. And here you are, you join the company, and in 5 days you realize that you can't meet any of them. And one does realize the value of personal connects, when you go through this. It's been now 5.5 months. Technology has evolved. It's very helpful. So you can actually have seamless conversations, connect with people on video. And when you are doing video conferences with people who are all sitting at their homes, you kind of get into their homes because, at times their kids come in and then, you have dogs walking around. And so it does provide a bit of personal connect, but I think it still does not give you as much as you would like to have to build a rapport, especially with people that you have to work very closely with. So I would say that IT services industry probably is a lot more prepared than many other industries. And I can't even imagine the challenge some of the brick and mortar companies, some of the manufacturing companies will be going through. But at least for me, in IT services, geography had already become history. Most of the things you are doing virtually, you are connecting with customers, with suppliers, with, your peers, with your team, everybody, on phone, on video. So I would say that largely, it has not been a big challenge. But I would have loved to have, ability to meet up with people as well.
Yeah, so I think, few months to meet up people, build a connection, and then work from home would have worked better for you.
Or maybe, intermittently have the ability to connect. So, 4 or 5 days work from home, then have 2 or 3 days of connect, again 4 or 5 days work from home. Some bit of connect is certainly, helpful.
So professionally, was it a challenge? I mean, to manage the team, to manage your bottom line, top line. Do you see that the pandemic brought in a lot of challenges? How was that?
Absolutely. I mean, on one side, you are trying to solve for a completely new model of working, right? I mean, everybody is trying to figure out. Delivery has to be different. How you sell is different. How you hire people is different. How you onboard them is different. How you do an appraisal is different. How do you have a career conversation with your team is different. How do you prioritize what function needs to do is different. So everything is different, right? So when so many things have to be figured out, obviously there is a lot of effort required. And at the same time, you are also facing challenges because your clients are going through a challenge, right? So you are trying to be, as close to the client as possible. You are trying to be helpful to them because, these are the times when client, find the partners who they want to work with really long time. And we want to be there for our clients, right? We are helping them in transforming. We are helping them in managing in the new environment, whether it is building a new way of doing things or by helping them in cost management and so on and so forth. So this clearly was a very intense period, and I kind of almost jumped into it from day one, right? Means the good news is that Surya, who is my predecessor, he was the CFO till the 15th of May. So I got close to 2.5 months' time before I took over formally as the CFO. And in those 2.5 months, I completely focused on, you know, managing this whole pandemic, which, because that also would have meant taking a lot of calls, which would have a longer term impact. And Surya was primarily solving for, you know, everything of the past, to close the books, to make sure that the financials of the previous year are signed, the audit is done, and so on and so forth. So having Surya around helped. You know, people were supportive because I was new to the system. And when you are working in a crisis, you anyway work with intensity. So in some ways, you know, working with that intensity closely with some of these people accelerated the whole pace of knowing each other, accelerated the whole pace of, I would say, induction into the company, which probably might have taken a little longer if, you know, it was easy and we had the luxury of time to ourselves. So I think we did a few things right. We were, you know, always closer to the customer. We, I would say, were fortunate that from an industry point of view, we were primarily working with clients of sectors which were not that much affected. And within the clients that we work with, we were working mostly on the transformation side of things, which also meant that, you know, when things have to change, the budgets actually increase in our side of business.
Correct.
And it gets cut on the run the business side. So I would say that till now, things have been good, relatively. I mean, obviously, you know, it is nowhere close to what it was prior to pandemic, but it is better than what we hear around us, whether from other industries perspective or other peer group companies within the industry. And I guess we have come out as, you know, someone who has taken the right decisions at the right time and, you know, been really, really close to the clients, understand their needs, and have been able to deliver to that.
Yeah, I have been talking to so many people, and people always say that, you know, for the IT industry, it's very different. Like other sectors were really facing problem. For IT sector, it was actually an opportunity in disguise. So we had to really pick up. Do you see the same thing happening with Mphasis?
You know, the reality is, you look at any business, the smallest of the small businesses and the largest of the large businesses, they all are trying to figure out how to sell in the new environment, how to deliver their services in the new environment. And the answer somewhere to all of those questions is technology. You know, whether it is education, where, you know, all online education, you know, companies are booming, because the only medium by which, you know, education can now be provided to the kids is through an online medium. So on one side, it is the Baijus and the Unacademies of the world. On the other side, even the schools are using, you know, Zoom and, you know, Google Hangouts and various other platforms to reach out to the students. Now, that means more spend by the schools, more investments by, you know, these companies, and more investment by the individual students. Because, you know, everyone has to have equipment. At my home, you know, during the, you know, in the morning, I have my wife on yoga on an iPad. My daughter is on an iPad doing her school classes. My son is doing his internship on his laptop. And I am on my, you know, laptop doing my video conference. I can't do without 4 devices, right? Now, so whether it is in the hardware, whether it is in connectivity, whether it is in software, because each one of these, you know, work requires different softwares. So technology investment, basic from a family unit to any kind of business you take, whether it is delivery business, whether it is e-commerce, whether it is, you know, education, whether it is delivering media, I mean, you know, movie launches are happening online now, right? So everywhere, I would say the tech investments have gone up. If you look at the published results of some of the largest banks in the world, whether Citibank, JP Morgan, you will see that in absolute terms, not percentage terms, despite them seeing a reduction in revenue and profitability, their technology spends have actually increased. Because technology is now the only way you can sustain and continue doing your business, irrespective of what business you are in. And if you don't make the investment, and if your competitor does, very soon you will have competitive disadvantage and you will lose market share, right? So I think technology has been, beneficiary of, you know, allocation of funds, if you will. I think the interesting thing in that itself is that if X amount of money was being spent in technology earlier, it has gone up from X to, let's say, Y. But within that X, if a large part was being spent in run the business, I would say that a large part in Y is actually in change the business. So IT services companies who were primarily supporting legacy work, primarily looking at, you know, maintenance of current, you know, technology and infrastructure, would have got, you know, a lot of pressure because clients are wanting to take money out of that and put it in change the business. Because, you know, transformation is what is going to help them sustain and create a competitive differentiation.
So as a CFO, what are the two, three things, Manish, that you're looking at? I mean, I'm not going to say a challenge or opportunity, but, you know, what should be, I mean, what is your focus area, say, till close of 2020?
You know, one can easily get sucked into negativity and continuously think of cost takeout and cost cutting and, you know, reducing spends and, you know, starting to take decisions which may be very bad in long term. Or one can, especially if you have the advantage of a reasonable balance sheet with cash and with investors who are willing to support, try to see how you can make an advantage out of this situation, right? So at my point of view, and, you know, our organization philosophy has been to use this situation to, you know, be closer to the client, to make sure that, you know, we are gaining market share. We are delivering, you know, transformation to the clients, even if it means in the short run, maintenance of profitability and giving away all the benefits we are getting because of lower costs, because, you know, their travel cost has come down to zero. Our infrastructure costs have come down. So we are saying we will maintain stable margins, but invest all of the upsides so that we can gain market share. We can grow, we can get more business. We can, you know, help the clients, we can be relevant for the clients. And having that growth mindset versus having a cost reduction mindset is, I think, a very big differentiator between, you know, the CFOs who will be, you know, successful and those who will not. Because it is extremely easy to, you know, if you don't have revenues, there's no profits, right?
Correct.
If you have revenues, you can then talk about what is the margin I'm making. And then you can always figure out innovative ways of, you know, doing the right things and having the best ROI for your investment dollars. But being close to the customer and making sure that you are not losing a revenue opportunity and having that growth mindset. Don't get me wrong. You know, one does focus on whether we are spending the money on the right things. One is focusing on getting collections. We had some of the best quarters of collections ever in Mphasis. But not at the cost of revenue. So there is a very conscious effort to make sure that 60% of the conversation is on growth and on revenue, then 20% on cost and 20% on cash flows.
So, you know, you as a firm is investing a lot on AI, machine learnings, and, you know, you guys are one of the best in that. So what do you think that, you know, the growth for 2020 or 2021 would come from? Will it come from traditional technology infrastructure, or is it the new technology that will bring in the most growth?
From our point of view, 80% of our deal wins actually come from new gen technologies. So what we have done is we have defined 8 tribes in the company. And, you know, whenever we have to deliver something, we say that the village has come together, you know, all the tribes have come together, right? And each of the tribe represents a new gen technology, whether it is cloud migration to a Azure or an AWS, whether it is app modernization, whether it is, you know, a product-led thinking where you are doing APIs and you are doing, you know, design work for the front end, whether it is about data sciences, you know, using Snowflake and, you know, the latest technologies. So each of these we define as new gen technologies. And 80% of whatever deal wins that we are getting actually comes from new gen technologies. So at least for Mphasis, clearly, you know, new gen technologies, AI, ML, by the way, you know, are part of those tribes, you know, itself. So from Mphasis point of view, clearly, you know, we see most of our growth coming from new gen technologies. Legacy investments have been huge. And, you know, by the time they transform and become something new, it will be a while. So legacy spends will continue to be there, but I would be very surprised if it shows growth, let alone, you know, I would actually expect that pie to continuously shrink. So if you are, you know, primarily on the legacy side of things and not on the transform side of things, you know, there is a reason to worry.
The other thing I wanted to ask you is, you know, how important as a finance leader data to you? You know, how do you ingest data and how do you take your decisions on good data?
And that's a very important last two words you said, good data, right? So I think the first and foremost effort should go in ensuring that you know what is a good data. Then you have a process to collect that data. You have infrastructure to store that data. You have technology to process that data. And you have the intellect to kind of create actionable insights out of that data. Any one of these pieces missing, you know, will completely, you know, make the process waste. So getting the right data, storing it appropriately so that it can be used for processing by the right tools, and applying the intellect on it to create actionable insights and then acting upon those insights is when the data really becomes useful. So what we have been able to do is, you know, we have made sure that there is a single source of. So when it comes to whether it is financial or non-financial data, we have one single source from where people get their information. And we make sure that the data that resides in that source is what it should be. So for example, you know, many companies will have data of how many employees we have and, you know, what is the work that they are doing. But when you go a little deeper, you will realize that it has not been updated for 6 months, 9 months.
Correct.
So, you know, system may show that you have X number of people doing, you know, a data sciences work, but in reality, you know, they may have moved on to do something else. Some of them may have attrited, et cetera, et cetera. So far as we are concerned, for us, that data is real time. It is available at the click of a button, updated at an individual level. Now, when you have that and when you have to align with what projects you are getting and what projects are you are kind of, you know, getting out of, you know, it helps you in then allocating people appropriately, giving them the right jobs, making sure that, you know, your utilization is managed. You can deliver to client satisfaction. You can provide them, you know, much better insights about people who are there who can deliver their work. So the same thing if was not possible because either the data quality is not good or the updation has not happened or the systems are not aligned and it is broken, you are doing it on Excel spreadsheet, I can assure you that, you know, it is not just the efficiency which is lost. It is not just the profitability which is lost. It is just the, you know, you don't get the confidence to the customer that you can deliver. You are not able to be aggressive in bidding for a deal and it's a downward spiral. So I think data in the of the right quality, stored in the right way, processed appropriately, and, you know, right insights created out of it and used appropriately is when it really becomes valuable. And having that whole thing actually is what differentiates between those, you know, who are doing very well and those who are not.
Very well said. I come from a company which is, like, you know, which has the largest commercial data in the world. So we can completely understand and empathize with what you're saying. So yeah. My second question would be, like, you know, you're a global company and, you know, the global economy is going through such an ups and downs. So how do you manage those? I mean, you know, as a CFO, because you can see risk and challenges in different countries and different companies. So how do you, you know, prioritize and manage those vis-a-vis, say, a business is coming from somewhere where you know that the risk is very high, maybe a country. So how, you know, on a day-to-day place, you solve those challenges?
It's a, you know, in a way, if you think about it, one of the most important roles that a CFO plays is risk management, right? And you can either think of risk as a threat or you can use that as an opportunity. So at least the way we think about it is that, you know, risk is perceived and seen equally by everybody. Now, if we can find a solution to that risk, it becomes an opportunity. And if, let's say, our competition doesn't find a solution, then it becomes a competitive advantage. So at least, you know, our focus, whether it is client risk, whether it is geopolitical risk, whether it is currency risk, whether it is risk from people perspective, whether it is visa regulations risk, whether it is a risk of a project, we try. So, you know, in my mind, Mphasis has one of the, you know, one of the best risk teams, so to speak. We have someone who is the chief risk officer. His day job is to only think about the risks in the company and figure out a solution for those risks. So much so that, you know, our risk team has a full team developed for, you know, cybersecurity and data protection. And that team has done such a great job that actually we are now having them go and sell to our clients. And we have started getting projects because of the quality of risk management capabilities we have on the cybersecurity, on the data protection side. So that's probably an example of, you know, how you think of risk becoming an opportunity and a competitive advantage. So there are risks, obviously, you know, and our approach to which are the clients that we will, you know, work with, where we can really add value, segments that we will focus on and segments that we don't want to focus on. Some of those are reflected in where we are today, because if you think about it, you know, I don't want to be arrogant about, you know, we knew everything before it happened, but at least we had the processes and risk management framework in place, which allowed us to have a choice of which clients we will work with that didn't get affected as much when, you know, the pandemic hit. You know, we were not affected by the sectoral angle. And even in the sectors that we are working with, for example, you know, we have transportation and logistics as one of our key segments. And, you know, despite that segment be key, the work that we were doing with the client and the client that we were working with in that segment actually saw an upside because of this, because they were servicing a lot of e-commerce customers. And, you know, that volume really scaled when, you know, this whole pandemic thing happened. So I think, you know, risk management and risk frameworks are really seen to deliver differentiated outcome when some things go wrong. And we have seen that happen for us when pandemic has hit. So I would say that the same thing we apply when it comes to a client risk, you know, client concentration risk. And, you know, if you look at Mphasis, there used to be a consistent concern around DXC being a large revenue in our overall mix. You know, we have continuously shown that we have de-risked on that, and DXC has become a smaller and a smaller percentage of overall revenue. From a geography perspective, we were primarily US-centric. Europe has been doing amazingly well. It is growing much faster than US, and it's becoming bigger and bigger. So hopefully it's reducing our geography risk. And currency is something that we have a very planned philosophy of, you know, a consistent hedging policy, which is to ensure that we get a visibility to the exchange rate without necessarily trying to be a profit center. So I think like that, we have identified each of the main areas of risk. Then depending on the probability and potential of each one of them, you know, we have risk frameworks. And I would say we have had reasonable success with each one of them till now.
Excellent. I'll come to my last question, Manisha, with that. That what no, would no, no. you define as success for a CFO?
You know, the definition or rather the role description has been changing, you know, of the CFO over a period of time. You can think of the CFO as the marketing head of the company to the investing community. You can think of the CFO as, you know, as the partner in crime, so to speak, of the CEO. Because, you know, when you think about it, other than the CEO, CFO is probably the only person who has a full view of what's happening in the organization. Every other leader is, you know, focusing on one part of the business, right? And at the end of it, if return on investment is what's the primary goal of the company, you know, that's what the KRA of the CEO, CFO also is, right? So, hence, seeing him as the partner in crime of the CEO. Seeing him as, you know, the person who is ensuring, who is enabling the system. So, you know, enabling the system to take the right decisions. You know, it is very, many a times it is misunderstood that CFOs take decisions. The right CFOs actually enable business leaders to make the decisions. You know, if you have enabled each of the leader, you know, to take the right decisions, then you have created that many CFOs. You don't need to be person taking the decision then. You know, CFOs are seen as people who are conscience keepers of the company. It's very easy for, you know, there are many incentives for people to do things which may not be clearly black and white. And CFO's responsibility is to make sure that he upholds that level of integrity. CFOs are seen as people, or at least in my mind, are people who can, you know, who can really do the scenario planning, so to speak, especially when situations like COVID happens. You are not doing plan. It's not a plan. You know, you basically do scenarios and say, if this happens, we will do this. If this happens, we will do this. And last but not the least, CFOs can either become, you know, the negative source of energy and pull down the organization by focusing on cost, or they may actually become, you know, enablers and help business to, like, you know, look at positivity and invest in the right place and actually help them grow.
CFO is the enabler. That's the point I'm going to take from this interview. Thank Absolutely. You so much, Manish, for this. And I hope our viewers enjoyed this. We will come back very soon with another episode of CFO Club with you. Thank you so much.
Pleasure was mine, Naina, and great talking to you.